faire Toto.
If you can see the slides, you can follow them as you see on the site. Okay, so we will present you the study we done with Kostia on Skype. So we will tell you all those parts. First of all, we will explain you why we studied Skype. So in fact, when we install Skype, we can't see anything, so everything is obfuscated. The bandwidth is obfuscated, the network is obfuscated, so you cannot TCP dump, for example, to see if your password is going out of your network. You cannot identify peers because it uses AV technology peer-to-peer. And as Skype does packet forwarding, you cannot identify the destination of every packet. Skype reuse your proxy credentials, so it's a bit heavy. And this is why we done a study on Skype. Because, for example, when you install Skype, you cannot identify if the network the packets belongs to a Skype connection or to a evil hacker. From the binary, there is some protections that avoid the study of the binary. There is many anti-debugger tricks, anti-disassembling tricks, and cipher code. The fact that Skype is free. The fact that Skype is free is a bit suspicious as well, and it's not really open source. So we can see if the developers has put something evil in the code or something else like a backdoor or trial. And from the security chief, he can ask those questions, and so that's why we made the study on Skype. And so we decided to do a rule for our firewall to stop and ban Skype from some parts of our network. So to do that, we need to interoperability with Skype protocol. And so we asked first Skype to give us their specifications, but they refused. So the study starts. So first of all, the binary is ciphered. So when you launch Skype, that's because you can disassemble Skype. So first of all, Skype allocates memory because it will decipher the code in this memory. Then it will start a loop and deciphering every section of a ciphered code in this memory. To do so, Skype has some section description where it can, and this section can be recomposed in today's code. So here we can see that Skype loads information of the cipher section, so where the section starts and the length of the section. And it initializes the key to decipher the section. So we can recover the structure of the section description. So you can see that Skype describes its section by start address, size address, start address in the file, size in the file, and the protection file, protection flag. Because at the end of the deciphering, you have to put the section code in execute and the data code in read and write mode. So when you have that, you can recover those informations and then to find where the sections are located in the binary. The next step is to find the loop that deciphers the section. So here you can see that the loop is a simple XOR with some bytes, with a key. And the interesting here is that the key is updated at each round because this trick is used to avoid ciphering a padding section, because when you cipher a section, a padding section, with the constant key, the result will be the same constant. And so when you update the key, two bytes with the same value will give two different values. So now we have the deciphering algorithm, and then we can decipher our sections. Another trick is the dynamic endport the dynamic endport tables building. So you have in the binary the description in the import table of sections that are imported by the binary, and some sections, some functions are hidden and are loaded by the packer of Skype. So Skype has a generic structure that can generically load the DLL with a lot of load function, and and it can load the function by name and ordinal, and so the structure is like that. You have a description of the name. So if the name is if there is a name and the ordinal and the address is new, this means that Skype wants to load a DLL. When the name is new and the ordinal is not new and the address is different than the new, it's an import by ordinal. And when the name is not new, the ordinal is new and address is not new, it's an import by name. So with this structure, Skype can load a DLL, an import by name and an import by ordinal, like on the examples. So this is a summary of those protections. So you can see the binary before deciphering and after deciphering. So you can see that some code was ciphered in the binary. And you can see that 169 functions were hidden and 1674 were present in the binary. For example, if you look at the import table of the original binary, you don't see that Skype uses network. So, at the end of the function, Skype will reprotect each section, this file section, with its original protection. So the section is put as only executed function, executed section, or read-write section. And at the end, Skype will erase the code in memory of the deciphering algorithm. So it replaces it with new bytes. So this is a summary of the protection. You can see that we cannot dump the binary in RAM at each step, because here the code is ciphered, here it's ciphered, and the code is erased. So the code will go into the deciphered section, but it's still erased. And at the end, Skype will import its final import table, and the new import table erases the part of the original import table, so you cannot dump here the full import table. So all those protections are common in protections of shower and games, so that's not a new thing, but what can be underlined is here it seems that those protections are made by Skype people. It's not a commercial protection by Skype and included in the binary. This is important. So to bypass this protection, we have to read the internal descriptors first to distinguish cipher section, and then to read the key in the binary, the algorithm, and the import table description. So we have to merge the original import table and the Skype import table, which is the final one, and then to patch the final algorithm. But when you do that, the final Skype crashes randomly. So in fact, there is an integrity checks in the binary. When we did the unpacker, there was anti-surface detection. And when we patched the anti-surface detection, the Skype crashed. And so we tried to put hardware breakpoint on the test, and we see that there is some checksum that checks if the soft ice detection was there. So in fact, we tried to patch the checksum, and we saw that there was another checksum that checks the first checker. Okay. So we did that for 10 checkers, and we saw that there was more than 10 checkers. So in fact, the main chain is like that. So we have a sensitive code here, and we have some checkers that check this sensitive code, and you have another checksum that checks the first checksum, and so on. So the next step is to delay those checksum. So why those checksums are present in the binary? There is multiple reasons. It can be because it prevents binary modification from a hacker. It may be inserted to prevent the binary being infected by a virus, for example. Or it can be inserted because when you put a software breakpoint, you modify the binary in memory, and so the checksum is wrong, and then it can be inserted because Skype people wanted to avoid someone putting breakpoints in the binary. I think this is the third reason. So now we have to find those checksum in the code. To do that, we will see in the next slide the way we used. So we have to simulate every checksum to recover the good value of the checksum, and then to generate a patch in order to erase the checksum in the binary, and repeat that until total elimination of checksum. So this is the look of a checksum. So you can see that you have a pointer initialization that is a bit obfuscated. And you have a loop that loads the bytecode of the binary, and some arithmetic on this code in order to do the checksum, and then the date of the pointer, and the loop that will checksum the whole code. You can see that you have dummy bytes inside in the code. So what we can deduce is the checksum are a bit obfuscated first, because you don't have a direct code pointer in the binary, so you cannot spot the checksum easily in the code. And you can see that there is dummy bytes, and everything is a bit randomized. So it's very difficult to spot all the checksum in the code. That's what I said. So it's a bit polymorphic, every checksum is a bit different. They are inserted randomly in a place, in the random place in the binary, so it's, they are executed randomly, for example when you call a friend and when you put the about dialog box or something. And there is the loop is every time different, the range of the loop of the or the increment of the loop. You have a dummy mnemonic insertion. And the final test of the checksum is not trivial, so you don't have in the checksum a simple comparison between the final checksum and the good value. In fact, here, the final checksum is used to calculate a pointer that is used by Skype in the next code. So, if you modify the binary in memory, the checksum will result in a bad pointer, and so Skype may crash in the future. So it's very hard to know if it's a real crash or it's a crash because you made the modification to the binary. So in fact, checksum have a point in common. They all have a pointer initialization that will result in a code pointer at the end of the initialization. They have a loop that will do the checksum. A lookup in the loop to get the bytecode, and a final computation to make a pointer or the test of the checksum. So now we can try to build a script that detects the checksum in the code. So we built a script that try to recognize some regex mnemonic in the code. So it tries to find at an address, it tries to find a lookup in a registry. So an arithmetic computation with those registers. So an update of the pointer, and then a loop to the lookup of the code. And this is to spot the main loop of the checker in the code. This is based on the IDA plugin. So if the plugin detects such code, it will try to disassemble back the instruction and to find the initialization of the final register, which is a mob from a constant to a register or XOR register, and some arithmetic values. And the problem is to find the final value at this point in order to check if the final value of the register points to the code location. So we use the x86emu, which is an emulator plugin in IDA. And then we, in the script, we force the emulator to emulate this part of the code in order to compute the final value of the register and to see if it's a code pointer. If it is, this means that we are in front of a real checksum of the code. So now we have to calculate the real value of the checksum to delete the checksum. It's based on x86emu again. So it, in fact, it emulates the loop of the checksum, and it tries to detect the conditional jump at the end of the loop, and it loops until the jump condition is not is bad. So this means that we are at the end of the loop, and so we have the good value of the checksum in the register. So then we can replace the code of the we can spot first all the checksum in the code. So on this chain, we have a scheme, we have each rectangle is a checksum of code, and a row means that this checksum checks the integrity of this one. So you can see that there is more than 10 checksums in the code, and you can see that the main scheme is a double check of checkers. So there is about 300 checksums in the code. I think I have missed one here. Maybe it will crash on landing. So we have to erase them. As I said, we compute the final value of the checksum with the emulator. And so we patch the final code and replace it. We replace the whole loop of the checksum by a simple affectation by the good value. Once you have done that with all the checksum of the code, Skype runs faster. So this is an example of the post checksum. So you can see that the patch is not based on this code, but only on the loop. And you can see that if you remember the code, that it's the loop that has been replaced by the affectation of the register and its good value. Computated with the emulator, and so the jump at the end of the checksum and the use of the register to calculate the pointer of something in the code. A last verification is integrity based on the RSA, on the signature. So in fact, at the beginning of Skype, it checks its own integrity by verifying the digital signature of the binary. So a simple patch can erase that. Okay, so now we'll see anti-debugging techniques used in Skype. First of all, Skype has something against soft ice, I think, because all the checks are done against soft ice. So the first one is very very simple. We'll see that next. And there is a generic anti-debugger, like a timing measure to see if the function is trusted or not. And the integrity checks are also anti-debugger techniques, because if you put a breakpoint in the memory, a software breakpoint, This means that you modify the memory, and so the Skype crashes. So it's a kind of anti-debugger technique as well. So the first test, the first anti-soft ice is a simple load driver soft ice. So it tries to load the video driver of soft ice. If it's okay, this means that its memory, so soft ice, is present, and then Skype say it with the direct box, and you don't have the permission to run soft ice while the Skype is running. But if you pass this test, you have another hidden test, and this time it doesn't cut the dialog box, it crashes. So the other technique is to parse the list of drivers in memory and to find the name of soft ice in this change list. So here you cannot see that it tests ntice.sys in memory. But Skype people made other tests. They tried to detect anti-soft ice. So, in fact, the plugin icex.sys is a plugin that adds some function to soft ice and hide a bit soft ice. And so they try to detect that anti-detector. And another test is done on proof 2.6. And I don't know, I don't have a clue on this driver. I don't know if someone in the room knows 12.2.6.6. I think, in fact, there is another tool called FrogEyes, which is a tool that can hide soft ice. And in fact, this driver runs hide soft ice and hide itself, and to hide itself, it generates a random name of the driver. And I think it generates a random name called 12.2.6.6, and maybe Skype people see that this driver was called 12.2.6 and then made a protection against 12.2.6. But in reality, the next time we launch this driver, it will be called I don't know, Jimmy.sys, and so the protection is in phishing. The last one is protection again with using timing measure. So it is very simple. It tries to do timing measures on the on runtime to check if function the time that function takes to run is good, because when you trust a function manually, the time is very long, so it can be detected like that. Also, protections don't kill Skype, in fact, because it will be too easy to come back to the responsive code and the detection code. In fact, it creates a bug in the Skype. In fact, it creates a random box in which the CPU will be cut when the debugger or something is detected. And in fact, everything in this box is randomized. You can see that the stack is randomized and all the registers are randomized. And it jumps to a page mapped to the in a randomized place. So when your and bytecode executed in this page are random. So when Skype detects the debugger, it will jump to this place, randomize all, and then it crashes. But you cannot come back to the code because you don't have a stack because it's randomized, so you cannot see where it came from. You cannot do anything. But there is a weakness in this protection. In fact, the page with randomites is created with a special attributes properties. It creates with execute, read, write properties, so you can trust all the malloc in Skype and to flag the malloc with those protections, and then to trust the pointer of this page, and then to put an adverb point, and then to detect the jump before it jumps, so you can back to the code responsible to okay again. Then you can come back to the code that is responsible to the jump before it jumps to the random place. is clear? Sorry. Okay, so we can detect the subtype detectors. Okay, so another trick, a bit hard, is code obfuscation. It's uncommon in classic code. In fact, it has advantages and disadvantages. The first one is then it slows down the code because it adds a dummy register and dummy code in the good code. It adds it avoids direct code stealing, so you cannot read the code in the target and put it in your binary. And it grows the size of the software, but it's very efficient against the study of the code, because we will see that in next slide. First of all, it replaces static calls by dynamic calculus computations. So you can see here that you have a call to a function, and in fact it has been replaced by a register, a call to a register, and the value of the register is computed just before. And in fact, you can see that there is another call to the register, but the register has been modified in this one. So when you learn this code, when you study this code, you are firstly to see the initialization of EAX, so the call. Here you can see that the computation of EAX is there, and then come back here, then do the computation of EAX on the register, and then go to the other subfunction. So it's a bit hard to reverse that when you do only a static analysis. It forces the attacker to do a dynamic analysis. Other obfuscations are insertion of dummy conditional jumps. For example, you have here a conditional jump in the code, and you can see that it's based on the condition, based on the value EBM minus 29. And in fact, this value is always repositioned to this value. So the jump is always down or never down. But when you study this code statically, it's very hard to see that because there is a lot of code here between the affectation and the test. So for those who doesn't speak x86 in C, this means this is the code. But I will delete this slide. Another technique is the rerouting of execution flow. It's based on the fact that the code, instead of executing the code binary, the code will do errors. So we have an exception handler that will take the error, put the code in another subfunction, and go. So when you learn again the code statically, it's hard to see where the execution flow go. We will see, in fact, where this code is used. And to see that, we will study the part that obfuscates packets, because if you have a binary that is a total black box, the thing to do is to try to reverse its and to study its protocol using TCPDEB or something, but in fact, we will see that this is not possible because packets are also obfuscated. So in fact, they are obfuscated because they are composed of two clear bytes, and all the other bytes are ciphered in RC4. So this is the type of a packet. So Skype uses UDP. So you have the IP packet, the UDP, and so the sum only two bytes that are clear, three in fact. And so everything after is ciphered. And in fact, it's only obfuscation because the key, in fact, the seed of the key is in the packet. So you have to read the packet, to read the key here, and then to decipher the packet. But it's not so simple. In fact, the key is generated using the obfuscated function, we call flux capacitor. So the mechanism is simple. To obfuscate the packet, you take the source IP, the destination IP, the ID which is included in the packet here. You take the IV of the packet, which is clear, just here. So you give a seed on 32 bytes. So you go in the flux capacitor, and it gives back a 80 long RC4 key. And this key is used to decipher the next payload of the packet. And this flux capacitor that is obfuscated, that is heavily obfuscated in the binary. In fact, there is a first problem in Skype. It's how to know it's a source IP when you are NAT, for example. In fact, Skype sends a packet with a null IP. It ciphers the packet with a null source IP. And the target receives the packet, but it cannot decipher the packet because when you are NAT, the source IP is replaced by the gateway. And sends back another packet, and it says to the first machine, hey, I can't understand what you say. And then it gives back the public IP of the source. So this is how Skype knows that his public IP on the network. The second problem is how to get the code of the flux capacitor, because this function is heavily obfuscated. It's a big fat function in the binary, so it's tons of ASM assembly lines. It has been built to be the keystone of the obfuscation in Skype. So its mechanism is simple. It gets an input 32 bytes bits value, and it gives back 80 byte key. And it's very hard to study this code. But we have two solutions. The first one is to parasite Skype. So this is a flux capacitor. So the mechanism is simple. You have a Skype. You zombify the Skype. You Petras it. You inject a shell code in its stack. You put the program pointer in this shell code. And this shell code will create a unique socket that is the input of the key, and it will give back. The shell code will call the function in Skype, the obfuscated function, and it will give back the result in the socket. So this is the shell code. This is a brilliant solution Philip found, but in fact it's a The bad point is that you need a zombified Skype on a machine. And the other solution is to try to recover the C source code of the binary, which is a great solution. So this technique uses propagation values to recover the C code. So in fact, it's based on the fact that you have to mark first variables that are that you want to follow the data flow. For example, in our case, the in key. You have to follow every instruction that uses and writes those values. And so you have you recover, in fact, the mathematical expression of the value. And so you have also to monitor the memory writing in the code. And some execution flow speaking. For example, if you when you learn the code, when you study the code, you have to care to conditional jumps. First of all, you have to determine the execution flow. So this is the execution flow of the flux capacitor in Skype. So the entry point is there, and the endpoint is there. And but there is in the new Skype the flux capacitor 2000. So in fact it's again it's the same section but heavier, more heavy. It's for next version of Skype, in fact.
But does it do the same?
No, it gets an in key and gives back a SE4 key, but a different one. And they did that because, in fact, they saw that we had the first flux capacitor. And if I think one day they will say, hey, we have a marginal version, and the old flux capacitor doesn't work, and now you lose the flux capacitor 2000. And so we have to learn this function again. That's why we made an automatic code Llama study. So in this example, we have the code here. This is the function, the flux capacitor. And so you have the key that goes in the register and the location of the buffer, the old buffer in another register. So what we have to do in our script is to monitor those registers. And so we create in a pool, aliases that say that this register is the key to monitor and this one is the output. So now we will follow those registers in the code. So we have to first get the assembly of the code. So add a semantic x86 to the code in order to know data meaning of the assembly, to know where goes the value and the registers. We have to get the execution flow so we can recover the expressions of the code and then put a backend in order to generate back a C code or a Python code. So, for example, when you call the sub function, you have only in the pool those two registers. So, the first one is a mob, for example, and this means that the script knows that this means that you create another alias AEX, and the source is another alias EAX, and the source is AEX. So, the script evaluates the AEX register. It sees that this is an alias with key, so it will say that EAX is now another alias with key. Okay? So we have a push EAC, and the script tries to resolve EAC in its alias pool, but there is no EAC, so it will do nothing. So the code loads from EAC plus 1C in AEX. So the script tries to evaluate this operand. So it sees that ECX is out. So it creates another alias, ADX, that points to out index 1C. So the next line is the script that evaluates another operand. So it creates another alias EAC to out 28. So we have a subtraction. And it evaluates EDX, and it sees that EDX has an alias which points to out 1C. So this means that the code means EDX is equal to out 1C minus this value. Here, we have an XOR between EAC and EDX. So the script tries to find aliases with AAC and EDX. And it found those aliases here, and then it generates the expression EAC equals to out this one, XOR out this one. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so on. And here we have a role with EAC3, so it finds aliases, it generates the expression, okay? And at the end, there is final XOR and the red. So you can see that at the end of the subfunction, we have all the expressions done in this function to compute the final calculus. So now we have those expressions. We have to generate back the C code using simple rules, discard all intermediate expressions. So those ones are not used, and because the final register, the final computation is done here, the writing of out 28 by those values, and the return address of the function, meaning EAX, is equal to roll key 3 XOR this value. So it will only keep those two expressions. And then the backend that generates the C code will give this code. So you have a C code generated with a function and this code and this return. There is also a problem, meaning calling some functions. Okay, so in fact, we did the plugin using ARM version of Skype, because in fact, there is a less obfuscation in the ARM version than in the x86 version. So the script was based on the evolution of ARM. And here, you can see that the script tries to see the call of functions. Here you have move PC that you dot register. In fact, it means that you call the function, and you have to describe the parameters of each function to make the script understand the meaning of the code. So you can see that the script knows that the cosinus take only one parameter R0. And the sinus take only one parameter R0, and so on. And so the script can get back all the expressions and generate the code. And so this is a shot of the generated C code of a function. So I think I can do a little demonstration to be more precise. So this is the code, from the binary. So we will run the script on this code. So it will try to recover some expression and to get back the C code. So this is the Python script. So I run the Python script, and you can see that at the end of the script that it has generated all the functions from the binary. So you can see that it generated void toto with all the expressions. You can see that there is good expressions in the binary here. And now you can compile this output to get back the function that get an input and get back the result of the RC4 key. So at the final code, you give an in key and it gives back the RC4 key. Okay. This is the final flux capacitor C code. So you can see that there is some functions, some little functions. Which only does a simple computation here, only 2 bytes of C code, and there is a big fat functions which are composed of multiple tests and call to the function of little functions, and it is very fat. Okay. So to finish with, it works for Skype, but don't think it's a perfect tool that take an input assembly code and give back C code for everything. So don't ask, don't say me, hey, I have a big Windows points .exe, and can you test your tool to get back the source code of this binary? I think it won't work because it's I think it's a piece of shit for the moment. But it works for recovering simple expressions and simple functions from a simple binary. So to finish with, I think we can build a more complex tool and with a better execution flow analyzer, a better detection of writing to local stack variables, because it's for the moment a problem, and using a better semantic of the ARM. And I think we can do the same for x86 code, because if you have a file that you have a good semantic of x86, you can do the same thing with ARM. We took ARM code because the assembly of ARM is very simple, and so the semantic description of the ARM is simple, and with x86 code it's a bit more complex. So I've got some questions.
Why didn't you use DCC instead?
In fact, the code is too many of succeeded to run such tools, because DCC tries to recover the C code, the whole C code, and if it's obfuscated, it doesn't understand and can't disassemble the program. For example, with the computation of dynamic calls, DCC does shit. Does bad things.
All these techniques that were built into Skype, do you think this was hand-coded, or did they use some sort of commercial library that, you know, ran, like a meat grinder, you put in the code and they put in all this randomized approach? Because it seems to me that this was not done ad hoc, this was done using sound mathematical properties of code, of random data in order to thwart your very great attempts.
I think that they have an automatic code generation. I don't think it's a commercial one. I think they build their own code generator, but I don't know. I think it's automatic, but not public.
Could you talk about a method of eliminating the checksum? Where you described 300 checksums within the code, I assume they were all checksumming unique blocks. What happens if your checksums are, you build your checksum into a block of code so that they're
co-dependent. Can you deal with that sort of issue? In fact, there is a problem of redundancy, because if you do a checksum that checks another checksum, and this checksum that checks the first checksum, you have to know in this checksum the final value, and this one the final value of the first checksum. So you have a problem of redundancy.
Yeah.
Like if you have a GCC and you try to compile GCC with GCC. You have to have a binary of GCC first in order to build the first GCC if you want to compile your libc or I don't know.
Chicken and the egg.
So this is, yeah.
There was a paper that described such a technique.
Yeah, you could store the result somewhere else and then patch it.
Mm.
Because code is one thing, and then the result of the function is different. So you don't need to embed the result of the CRC function in the function itself.
Yeah.
You could do it somewhere else.
Okay.
You didn't do it.
Yeah. So. But you can patch only those out checksums.
Sorry if I missed this, but in your slides, was there any sort of secret key involved in like a whole 32-bit value that goes into this like key expansion function, or is it all just basically IV sort of info that's, that you can find from any package?
In fact, no. In fact, the IV is random for each packet. So when Skype wants to send a packet, it gets an IV, it put it in the packet, it ciphers the packet with this IV, and it sends it to the... So everything is public.
Oh yes, everything so can there's be. No secret key or anything like
that? No, no, no. You, when you decipher them, you get back the IV, so you can decipher the payload and then get back the unobfuscated packet.
Do you think they modify the compiler to do these kind of things, especially for the compute calls? Do they use a lot of compute calls for everything?
In fact, when you see the code, there is only two levels of undirectional calls. So you have one call that is called dynamically, and another, and it stops there. So maybe it's if they had such a tool, they would made with 100 levels to be very obfuscated. So I think it's not included in the compiler. It's a tool that takes randomly calls and try to compute the value and replace the assembly code.
So it's like an after compiler.
Yeah, I think.
Cool. I want to ask the audience something important. Is anybody from Skype here? Okay.
Or is that only one of the from Skype that's here?
Okay, thank you. So, second part after lunch.